This circuit board is of a Sharp mini split air conditioner outdoor unit. The PCB has experienced a blast, and someone has attempted to repair it, but it couldn't be fixed. The company has used a different system here. So first, let's understand what this system is, and then we will start the repair process. The customer has brought these parts as well. If we look at the capacitor, it seems slightly swollen from the top. In such a situation, this capacitor will no longer function properly. A capacitor like this will work sometimes, and sometimes it won't. It's a good practice to immediately replace such a doubtful capacitor. The next thing is this IC. If we look at the number on the IC, it is A6061H, and it's a switching IC from the Scan brand. Next, I received a 3.15 amperes and 250 volt fuse. I haven't checked if it's good or not. Apart from that, I have also received two diodes here, which have already been removed from their points. I'm not sure why it couldn't be fixed before, but I will certainly try to repair it. To fix this circuit, we first need to understand its diagram, which has a slightly different type of construction. Now, I'll clean it up a bit. Cleaning helps reveal many things, so cleaning is always a must. After cleaning, I will proceed with testing, as we have two diodes. We'll test both, and I've placed some masking tape underneath them so that it sticks in place. If we look at the diode's number, it's MA07. I will set the multimeter to diode mode and check the diodes. The cathode seems to be on the left side, but we'll confirm by testing both sides to get a clear understanding. It seems fine this way, and now I'll reverse the polarity. It's showing 0.551 voltage drop, which means the diode is perfectly fine. Now, I'll check the second diode. As you can see, the second diode is showing 0 voltage drop. We'll reverse the polarity and check again, and yes, it's completely shorted. This diode is entirely shorted. Whenever a diode like this is shorted, I consider it fully defective. I won't reuse it because when a diode gets shorted, there's a high chance it has become weak or has some other issue, which could cause further damage to the system if reused. Now, first of all, I'll solder the diodes. So let's prepare the spot. So here you can see I'm placing this diode. I'm soldering the regular dip diodes here. I'll solder this one, and its one pin is soldered. Now let's do the same for the other one, and both are now soldered. We already know the direction of the diodes. I'm using standard 1 amp diodes, rated up to 700 volts. Now I'll install the second one as well. Let's prepare the third spot and solder the third diode here. So I've soldered all three diodes now. Next, we move on to the RT2. The one I'm going to install is an R051 resistor with a tolerance of 5%. It's a 2-watt resistor. So I have installed this resistor. Let me solder it now. I have soldered its first pin, and now I will solder the second one. Now I'll desolder these IC pins. Both these holes are cleared. These rest of the four are also cleared. I will install the new IC here. The first pin is oriented this way, so I will place it accordingly. The IC has been placed in its soldering pads. Let's push it down and proceed to solder it, and now it's soldered. Similarly, I am connecting these two points since they are linked. Now we'll clean the fuse area because installing the fuse is also essential. After that, I will suck the solder from here. I have a 4 amperes, 250 volt fuse, which I'll install here, and we're done with that step. Now, let's solder the fuse here. I have tested all the resistors, and they are almost all in good condition. So, I'll directly point out the fault in this circuit. It's quite simple. When you check the resistors, one of them might come out faulty, or there might be a faulty diode connected to it, and I have already changed this switching IC. But the person who tested this earlier did not check these resistors. By seeing through this microscopic camera, I found this resistor is burnt. You can also see another burnt spot on this other resistor. Now I will show the difference in the values of these resistors. I have switched the multimeter to ohms mode, and I will check them. On placing the probes on these resistors, it is showing 11.14 mega ohms of resistance. Both these resistors will show the same value because they are connected in parallel. Because of this, the SMPS wasn't fixed. Now, I'll desolder and replace these components. Let's heat them up and remove them for replacement. I've removed both resistances, and they were 2.2 ohms. Now I'll replace them with new resistors. The new one is slightly larger in size, but due to the current situation, I'll use a 3.6 ohm resistor here. Although it's a bit larger in capacity, it doesn't matter because my goal is to get the system running. Now, I'll proceed with soldering the new resistor. It's done. I'll solder the second one as well, and that's also done. I will push this capacitor back into the circuit. Now, I'll put the relay back in place and solder it properly. But before soldering, I'll bend the pins slightly. Bending the pins ensures that the relay stays securely in place and doesn't fall out during the process. Now, I'll solder it in place. Lastly, we have the capacitor to install. It's a 100 microfarad, 450 volt capacitor. We'll install it properly, making sure to observe the correct polarity, negative and positive, to avoid any issues. I've installed it in the circuit board, and now I'll tilt the pins so the capacitor doesn't come loose. Let's go ahead and solder it. Here we go, the soldering has been completed. Now it's time to test the circuit board. I've already completed all the connections. I'll provide power to the board, but unfortunately, it didn't turn on. Let me check if the power is reaching the terminal. The tester shows that electricity is indeed flowing, and the red light is on. I will turn the power off, and I will discharge the capacitor just in case it's still holding a charge. It's been discharged. Now we'll apply the reference voltages here, as without them, the circuit won't turn on. I've reconnected the power, and I've turned on the switch on, but it still hasn't powered up. So, let's apply the reference voltages. After applying the reference voltages, you can see the PCB short-circuited again. However, the PCB is now fully repaired. But before demonstrating that it's working correctly, I'll explain the working principle and why I had to apply the reference voltages. Once you understand the principle, it will also become clear why I applied the reference voltages and whether they were necessary or not. So, stay tuned for the next video, where I'll explain everything in detail to help you fully understand the process. See you in the next video.